Welcome back. Despite numerous casualties and the economic downturn from the COVID-19 pandemic, the disease is now also threatening the country's nuclear power plans. The Nuclear Energy Corporation of South Africa presented a restructuring plan to Parliament in May. According to that plan, the company's yearly losses were supposed to go down by around 100 million rand, but because of the continued lockdown, losses are now expected to increase to around 300 million rand for this financial year. For more on this, energy sector analyst Chris Yelland joins me on the line from Pretoria. Chris, as always, a pleasure to speak to you. So tell us, how has the coronavirus pandemic impacted the restructuring financial turnaround plan for Nexa? Chris, can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you.
Sorry, did you hear my question?
Yes, I got it. Thank you. The chairperson of Nexa, David Nichols, has indicated to me that Nexa has taken a really serious hit as a result of the COVID-19 lockdown and crisis. A lot of it, I think, is to do with the fact that some of its products, or many of its products, are exported and used locally, of course. But this has really played havoc with their whole supply chain. A lot of their product is transported by aircraft, by airplanes, and this has been inhibited significantly. So I think it's really due to just limitations on trade and business, both locally and globally.
Now, Chris, the financial situation was dire prior to COVID-19, hence the need for restructuring. But is the plan put to Parliament in May this year still viable or realistic given the effects of the pandemic?
No, it's completely unrealistic. And to be honest, many observers have indicated that the plan was unrealistic even before the COVID-19 lockdown. If you were to look at the plan and how it turns around a company that has been running at a loss for many years to suddenly turn this into a profit and a massive profit by the end of the decade, I think it can be said that it was unrealistic from the start. Perhaps very, very optimistic. But, you know, plans should really present realistically as well as optimistic and pessimistic options so that one can get a clear idea. But this particular plan was just the optimistic plan.
Chris, what are the repercussions on the labor force and the three-year collective wage agreements entered into? That's also going to impact this plan quite drastically.
Well, in terms of the plan, there was, to turn the company around, there was a need for a massive cost reduction. And the first thing that was done on the 1st of April this year was that there was a freeze on wages and salaries from workers through to staff, through to middle and senior management. In fact, everybody across the group was going to take zero increase at all. And this has resulted in conflict because there was a three-year collective bargaining agreement in place, and the third year of this agreement is this year. And that agreement was for a salary increase this year. And so the freezing of salaries was seen by labor and the management and staff as really a breach of a legally binding collective agreement that had been reached some years earlier between management and staff.
So in operating a nuclear reactor, workforce morale, adherence to safety and compliance is of utmost importance. How is the Nexa board planning on resolving those wage and increase issues to ensure that those safety standards are met?
Yeah, so the board, I've spoken to the chairman of the board, and he's indicated that they are still engaging with labor and with management and staff to try and explain that the freeze, wage freeze took place even before the COVID-19 crisis in terms of the turnaround plan. And the COVID-19 crisis has simply made things incredibly worse. And so they just do not have the money to pay the increases. In fact, there have been regular reports, that Nexa might even have to default on payment of salaries or just not have enough money to pay salaries. And in fact, there has also been cuts in fringe benefits. So they really point to a very dire financial position, which means they simply don't have money. One particular problem that has arisen is that one of the companies in the group, in fact, does have the money to pay wages and salaries. And so the workforce and the management have been saying, hang on, but in this particular subsidiary company, we do have enough money to pay wages and salaries, therefore, please honor the agreement. But I think the approach by Nexa's board is that really they cannot give wage and salary increases to one group company and not the whole group company. So it's a case of one for all and all for one. And what applies to one staff member in one subsidiary company is going to be applied equally to the other staff, even though the other subsidiary may be doing better than the first.
All right, thanks for that analysis. That was Chris Yelland, an energy sector analyst.